My name is Ben Livingston. I'm the first person to ever see the cloud with the intention to cause it to do military damage. I know I can say that, and I did it several times before the next person did it.
Tell me what these clouds are we're looking at.
Well, these clouds were located up in the southern part of North Vietnam, and we needed to make rain down on the Ho Chi Minh Trail, Highway 1. But there weren't any real clouds around. There were a number, this was the end of the monsoon season, but there were a number of these small clouds that barely reached the freezing level, and by putting a small amount of silver iodide in there, we got them to collect and start to build. And as they built, we just worked on the largest tower in the group until in a very short time. We had clouds that were...
You told me this cloud got 14 inches of...
Well, this cloud, of course, this is all the same cloud.
I was clear, top secret. Eyes only, I was as high as you could get. I got interested in weather modification when I was a farm boy. I never could understand why the clouds wasn't bigger, had a little more shade, and was chopping that cotton. So I got in the Navy. I managed to get into meteorology school, and I think that's really where I learned the most of my physics. I was assigned to the Typhoon Squadron in Guam, where I served for 3 years as a flat meteorologist and meteorological engineer. From there, I came back to additional school at Texas A&I University down in Kingsville, and from Kingsville, they sent me to the Hurricane Hunters Squadron in Jacksonville, Florida. That squadron, of course, had just become involved in Project Storm Fury. So when I reported to that duty station as a meteorological engineer, I was immediately designated the military member of the Storm Fury Advisory Board. We were doing quite a lot of testing work out over the test range at China Lake, California, where we drop cloud seeding flares or silver iodide generators into clouds or just where we wanted to see what the reaction was. And it was there when I learned for sure that you could really change a cloud by the amount of silver iodide you put in and where you put it.
This cloud here, from the time it started raining till it quit, it put out a little over 14 inches of precipitation.
What did that do to the North Vietnamese?
Well, it just washed all the roads out, and there was a bridge attached to a mountain that they'd bombed and could not get rid of it. This heavy rain washing out down that river took that bridge out.
So you guys finally got it done.
This was on October 13th. These are cloud seeding dispensing units on the side of C-130s. As you can see, these dispensers held 52 units. And under here, on this F-4, we had these camouflaged so they looked like they were...
Did you fly those?
Yes.
You piloted the F-4?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So you're a jet pilot too, huh?
Yeah, I did these for about 7 years.
You fly them all, huh? That's neat.
And these were our own airplanes, the airplanes I had in my commercial cloud seeding business. See? And a Duke, and a turbocharged Duke, of course, and Cessna 310 and a Turbo 210. And we built the flares, just built them into the wings of our airplane so that they caused as little resistance as possible, or drag as possible. And this right here, these are pyrotechnics that we've cut in sections and fused them so that they could burn either singles or a pair, or cut half in two, or cut in three pieces, or cut in five pieces. So you can see, obviously, here, although these are dispensed in the vertical, they are essentially a horizontal cloud seeding device. See? That's how we made these clouds, like in Vietnam, work, because we could take a cloud, take a pyrotechnic like this, had a little bitty piece in it, and we'd fly by and just barely touch the cloud with one part. So that kept from blowing the thing apart, blowing the cloud up. But what we would do, and like in Carla or Rita, those kind of clouds, we would maybe use, this is one cloud seeding device here, cut into five pieces. But in one like this, you may be flying 350 miles an hour, kicking one out every 200 or 300 meters, and just essentially seed the whole area on the horizontal, and the whole top would blow away.
Amazing.
We were the first ones to fly into hurricanes for the purpose of modifying them, if you will. That was Project Storm Fury. I began to be extremely confident that we could do whatever we wanted to with a hurricane. The Project Storm Fury had been going on since 1961, and they had already done or had done two experiments, one in 61 and 63. Well, by 1964, when I was there in 1964, I wrote the plan and started to have a track and a mission for every flight that was on the hurricane cloud seeding experiments. So we had documentation for everything. Operation and Project Storm Fury are very positive. His report said that we claim they should consider now if a hurricane heads straight towards Miami. Some wanted to continue hurricane reductions, and the other part did not want to. It was a political football, and there are people that were wanting to do more pure research and less application engineering wanted to kill Project Storm Fury. So they built up an artificial barrier that prevented hurricanes from ever qualifying to be experimented or seeded for damage reduction. NOAA research people came up with data that suggested that if a hurricane went through a certain little geographical area, there was no history in 100 years that a hurricane had been through that area ever reached land. So they made a requirement that the storm must go through this area of, I call it an area of improbability, before it would qualify for hurricane damage reduction attention. So after about 10 years, no hurricanes went through there, and the people, that is the scientists who didn't want to spend money on aircraft reconnaissance, decided, well, it's just too expensive. We can't wait any longer, so they killed the project altogether. I am terribly disappointed that the government have decided a long time ago not to do the hurricane damage reduction anymore. They can talk about the scientifically rigorous data, the inability of civilian aircraft and so forth to collect this data, and poo-poo the empirical, that is to say, the observation that you make just by looking out the window or watching your instruments, saying it has no value. In order to change the weather and know that you're changing it, you must have instrumentation or document it. So my line of business really was to design and make equipment that would document changes in the weather. You take a cloud that Mother Nature or God has provided, and you alter that cloud. Well, the reason the cloud doesn't expand on its own in most cases is the fact that there's a lot of moisture, but there's no nuclei. There's nothing for the moisture to stick to. So when you provide the silver iodide nuclei, it causes the water to coalesce to that nuclei, and when it does, it releases heat, which means everything starts to rise. If you produce enough nuclei at the right places in a cloud, there's essentially no limit to how fast and how far it'll grow, because it just keeps releasing heat as it goes up, and of course the heat keeps trying to rise.
So with the nuclei, it's very small, and they're put off by these flares, but then water starts attracting to it, and then it builds condensation.
Well, you put out a G into these, silver iodide nuclei, and they attract water. They just sponge it up. But when they do, that water condenses, and it releases what they call the latent heat of condensation. The heat goes out of it, and the whole thing starts rising. If you're in the business of trying to kill clouds, then of course you go up to the area where there are some vertical shear, the wind blowing some direction or other, and you provide the nuclei at a level above where the raindrops are. They are then so light that the wind vertical shear merely blows the top of the cloud away. Then there's no place for the coalescence or the nucleation to take place. Well, the Joint Chiefs of Staff had been wishing for quite some time, in terms of years, that they had some way of slowing the truck down in Vietnam. That led me to advise the Joint Chiefs of Staff that we had a potential weapon system, and so I was asked to start to put together a top secret operation to go to Vietnam to see if we couldn't make it rain more over there as a military operation. All the roads over there were dirt roads, and when it rained, it caused them a lot of problems. So that during the monsoon season, there was so much rain and water in the roads that the trucks really couldn't move very freely. Our mission was to make it rain during the dry season. On that particular day, the clouds were very small. There just weren't any real big thunderstorms or anything like that. But I picked a cloud that was sitting out essentially by itself with a number of small clouds. I'm talking about clouds whose tops were somewhere near the freezing level, but not high enough to really grow. And I nurtured one of those clouds until it finally got it in well past the freezing level, and then the cloud developed a lot of convective activity and it started sucking clouds into it, just building up and building up. And I took a series of pictures where I called for 41 minutes. By the end of 41 minutes, we had flown up to over 65,000 feet and we still couldn't reach the top of the cloud. So we knew we had a barn burner there. And by the next morning, we had washed out everything in the world and did a lot of damage to people and all that sort of thing, but it was a real success as far as blocking the roads off. With just two of us involved, myself and a civilian, but we conducted that operation with aircraft, military aircraft, mostly from Marine Corps, and then shortly thereafter we started involving the U.S. Air Force. Well, we actually began the 3rd or 4th of September, and by the 13th of October, we had had a couple of storms that had actually washed out bridges, and the results were so successful until I was called down to Saigon to brief the generals, the Air Force generals, the Army generals down there, and they suggested that I need to go make this report to President Johnson back in Washington, D.C. They were excited about it, but they had no authorization, if you will, to use this as a military weapons system. I was there in very top secret classification as a research project. That's the way we were able to conduct a mission without the international community, if you will, being apprised of what we were doing and how we were doing it. It was kept top secret for a long time. It was first reported that this was going on in 1972. That's the first time the Congress ever heard about it. So as you can see, it was not something everyone knew about for a long time.